Very happy. Very happy that Jerry could make it once more, and we'd like to welcome him very much for his lecture on contractile mechanisms.
Thank you, Walter. I'm happy to be here as usual. And for those who have been here before, I apologize because this talk is going to be very similar to what you've heard. So you have an opportunity to depart now, if you like. But anyway, I do have some things to tell you, and Walter is absolutely right. I think the evidence makes me wonder whether the theory that we all accept as absolutely true, pretty much, is completely wrong. And that's what I want to talk about today. And I think you'll see why I think so. So we talked about the contractile mechanism, and this is one of my favorite slides. It's done by a colleague who was in my lab for quite a few years, Charles Trumbitash, and it's insect flight muscle, which is really beautiful to look at. And you can see the myofibrils nicely lined up. You can see the interconnections between them, and the little blobs are mitochondria. Okay, and so I'll talk about what is the cross-bridge theory adequate. And then, of course, you know, if it's not adequate, then what's adequate? And I want to bring you to some fresh ideas that I think are more compatible with the evidence. Okay, so this is where we start. And I think I'm not sure if the version that you taught is similar to this, but you all know the idea the cross bridges somehow make contact with the actin filament and undergo a rotational cycle, and they keep cycling on and off in some random way. And that brings about contraction of the muscle. So question is, you know, you've all read about this, learned about it, you've seen evidence in favor of it, but how do you actually test a theory? So of course you test a theory by bringing forth predictions and seeing if the predictions make sense. And so that's what I want to do to start with. So what are the predictions of this model? What do we expect? I think you already know what I'm going to be talking about, but I want to bring it forth in the context of predictions of a theory. So, okay. So the first one is that the amount of tension you get depends on how many cross bridges are operating. I think everybody can agree with that. And from that, you get that tension, active tension, should be proportional to the overlap of the thick and thin filaments. Because when you pull it out, you know, there are very few cross bridges that can make contact with the actin filament. Probably you've gone over that, I think. But okay, so here's the theoretical prediction. And on the right, you can see the equivalent sarcomere configuration. So if you look on the left, you know, you see points A, B, and C here. And at point A, the sarcomere, at least in vertebrate skeletal muscle, it looks something like this, where the thin filaments fully overlap the cross bridges. So you should be able to get the maximum amount of tension. But if you pull it to B here, you've pulled it out just a little bit, but since there are no cross bridges here, you shouldn't get any difference of the amount of tension. So now we're at point B. And if you start pulling it out more, ultimately to point C, of course, at point C, there's no longer any overlap of thick and thin filaments, so the tension should be zero. And there should be a linear relationship between the tension produced, the sarcomere length, and the tension produced. And I think you all know that. Okay, and the question is, what do the data show? And I think if you've been exposed to this, you probably have seen some of the data. So here are the results that are compiled over a period of many years. It's when I wrote that book that you just saw. It's a kind of surprise, you know, because a whole bunch of the ones at the bottom, including the authors, the result fits the theory pretty nicely. You'd say it fits extremely well. On the other hand, there are six or seven up there and that don't fit the theory. So in the ones up here, you get pretty much the same amount of tension from full overlap until pretty close to half maximal overlap. So you're changing the number of cross bridges, but you're not changing the amount of active tension. So the question I raise for you is, well, you know, which one is right? Which one should we believe? So if this set of results is correct, then it fits the theory pretty nicely. Doesn't mean the theory is proved, because you can't prove anything, but it certainly shows that it's compatible. But this one doesn't fit at all. And if this is the right one, so to speak, then there's a problem with the theory, because the result doesn't fit. So which one is right? There has been a hypothesis, and the hypothesis comes from some of the people who did these experiments. They said, the people who did these experiments don't know what they're talking about. They're lousy experimentalists. They did everything wrong. And therefore, you should discount this. And that's why you haven't seen this in your textbook. You might have seen this, but you haven't seen this one. And the evidence that that theory is incorrect is that you can actually see the same names both on this group and this group. So, for example, you see this is the famous one, is Gordon, Huxley, and Julian. But the same Gordon produced a result that was in this group. So, you see this paper by Turkers, who's at this university et al. He did this in my laboratory. And another work comes from my laboratory. So they're the same investigators in two groups, which means it doesn't seem that it has something to do with the competence of the laboratory. So that theory seems undermined. So what is the difference? Well, if you look at these experiments versus these experiments, they were done in a different way. And in the top group of experiments, they were done very simply. You take the specimen, the muscle, and you grab it, and you stimulate it, and you measure the maximum amount of tension that's developed, and then let it relax, and then stretch it out some more and do the same, and the same, and the same, and you plot all the points, and that's what you get. And there's a potential problem with that experiment, because you hold it at a certain length and you activate it, and some of the sarcomeres may shorten and stretch other sarcomeres. And so there's some non-uniformity that you pick up in experiments like that. And therefore, you know, you may question whether the experiment is valid. However, in some of these, I know because one came from our lab, in some of these experiments, great care was taken to select only those fibers where the uniformity was very small, only up to a few percent or so. So now, in this set of experiments, what the experimenters did was to take a small length along the muscle and use a feedback system. You stimulate, activate the muscle, and make sure that that section was at constant length, not changing at all. And then you stretch the muscle out, next contraction, and again, hold it at that particular length. So it's absolutely isometric. See, and then you get this result. So it would seem that this is the better way to do it. However, we raised the question. This was some years ago. We said, well, look, when you do this experiment, you get less tension than when you do this experiment. So if you really want to find out what the maximum amount of tension at any given sarcomere length, you have to perhaps let the sarcomeres shorten, the others will stretch, shorten just a little bit. That was the hypothesis. And then you get maximum tension. So we tested that in a paper, and this is just one trace from the paper to give you an example of what we're talking about. So here's time, and here's force or tension. And here's the sarcomere length. So what we did is we imposed the sarcomere length clamp. We held a region of the fiber at constant length. So we activate, we get this amount of tension. We held it at this sarcomere length, which is a modest amount of overlap. And then we imposed a small shortening. And you can see here the shortening is, what is it, 3% or something? Anybody calculate? Or maybe 10%? It's 10 out of 3, well, whatever. 3%. 3%. Yeah. By the way, we found that a half a percent is sufficient to get the result that I'm showing you. So what happens is that during the release, there's a transient here, and then you're holding it, again, isometric at a shorter length, and the tension builds up, but it builds way beyond the original tension. So all you've done is taken, letting it shorten it just a little bit, and the tension is much higher, you see? And we did, of course, many experiments. This is just one example. And so we found out that this kind of experiment where you hold the sarcomere length constant gives you not the maximum amount of tension, but a sub-maximum. What you need to do is to allow, as I said, something like 0.5%, just a small amount of shortening is all that's required for the sarcomere to develop its full tension. And the full tension is up here. See, so that occurred automatically in all of these experiments because when these experiments were done, there was no clamp. What happened is you activate and some sarcomeres will shorten a little bit, stretching others. So that condition was fully satisfied in these experiments, and that's why you got the full tension. So if you want to record the full tension at any particular sarcomere length, it follows this curve. And that's why all of these curves practically superimpose, and there's nothing in between. Here you're getting the maximum. So if this is indeed the maximum, then the maximum hardly varies with the length of the sarcomere over a broad range, which is inconsistent with the theory. Your textbooks always show this one, never this one. And here's just an example. This was done, as some of you may know, Dilson Razia, when he was in my laboratory. And so here's tension versus time, and here are the length of sarcomere. This was done with a single myofibril. So you put the single myofibril in the bath, and you add the activating solution, and you get tension. And then you change it back to a relaxing solution, and you get the baseline again. There's a bit of a transient here that's omitted. And then you look at the length of the sarcomeres. And there are two groups that were measured with the particular technique. And so one of them is 6 sarcomeres in one region and 3 sarcomeres in another region. And the average length of those 6 is shown here. So it starts very long, just at the edge of overlap, and then goes down to perhaps 10-15% of maximum overlap. And in this case, the sarcomeres go way down, they shorten, and the 3 sarcomeres go to full overlap. Main point, they're all in series. It's a single myofibril. And one group of sarcomeres has very little overlap, and the other group has maximum overlap. And because they're in series, one group here, they must bear the same tension. So the same tension is born or generated or sustained at 2 completely different degrees of overlap. And that's not permitted by the theory. Okay, so that's one. Next prediction is that if you stretch the sarcomere to the point that there's no overlap anymore, you expect no tension. Right? I mean, the cross bridges can't attach anywhere on the actin, and therefore you don't get any tension. And I think you've heard or it's been implied that when you do that, you don't get any active tension. But if you look at the experiments that have actually addressed that fundamental question, they're all old. I don't think anybody in the past 10 years or so has addressed this question, or even 20 years or even more, because it's a solved question has been solved, and everybody knows that, of course, there's no tension beyond overlap. But you could conceivably get a tension because, as you know, the thick filament is connected to the Z-line through a connecting filament, and if you stretch beyond thin and thick filament overlap, if this connecting filament could generate active tension, and there's some evidence that, yeah, maybe that could be, then it could get tension. But that's a different theory. It's not the same theory. We're looking at testing the cross-bridge theory, no other theory. And so here's the result. This is every experiment that I found when I wrote the book that is sitting right there. And on the left side, you see a kind of scale model of, it says, contraction cutoff. That means if you stretch the sarcomere to just this configuration, you don't get any more tension. you can stretch it more and you still get no tension. But this is the critical configuration for still getting just barely any tension. And this is a Huxley paper. This is 1961. And they got what you might say is the right answer, because contraction stopped just at the point where there was no overlap. And another paper in 1964 got the same result. But these four got different results. And if you look at this one, the sarcomere had to be extended way beyond thick and thin filmed overlap before tension went to zero. That means if the tip of the thin film was here, here, or here, or here, you still got tension. And the same is true with each of these experiments. This one was done in limulus muscle, where the sarcomeres are much bigger, and there's no question about resolution of the optical microscope. And this group in particular, you know, this was done in 1965, and remember, the theory came forth in 1954. So we're talking a decade later. These people were under great pressure to do careful experiments. And these people there, it was a Danish group, and they scanned along the entire fiber with optical microscopy and then with electron microscopy to make sure that there wasn't a single sarcomere that really that showed overlap. So the studies were done really, really carefully in a case like that. And so the result is it's not so clear whether you can generate tension beyond overlap. We don't expect it, and so of course we tend to think that these are the good experiments and these experiments don't really count because we'd like to believe it. But taken at face value, the data are mixed. In fact, if you go back and look at these papers, it's really not so clear that the results are so convincing. So this is a really important issue because it's decisive for that theory. Now, what about the structure? So in order for this theory to work, you have to have a structure something like this. So what do you need? Well, the first thing you need is that this angle has to be able to change, because the distance between the thick filament and the thick filament is not fixed. It depends on a lot of factors, like, for example, the length of the sarcomere. So there's got to be a hinge here that allows this to kind of swing out. And then the stroke has to occur here. Why this second myosin head is there has never been really made clear, but there seems to be a second myosin head. So you need a variable change of angle here, and you need it here as well. So this is the, you might say, the minimally required structure. You've seen this diagram in many textbooks. The question is, you know, anybody could draw this diagram. My son is an artist who actually illustrated my latest book, and you know, he could draw whatever he wants, but whether it's true or not is another issue. So when you look at electron micrographs, do they really show this structure? Fair question. Okay, so we did a lot of studies on this, and this is a representative picture. So what you see here, this electron micrograph shows the thick filaments here. And in this experiment, the sarcomere had been stretched so greatly that the thin filaments are drawn out, so you can't see them. They're not in the picture anymore. What you do see are the connecting filaments, you see. So here's a thick filament, and it runs into titin, or connecting filament, which runs all the way to the Z line. So the reason for doing that is that when you have thin filaments overlapping the thick filaments, it becomes obscure. You can't really tell what the crossbridge shape looks like. So that's why we pulled it out. Now look at the crossbridges, and I'm asked the question, does anybody see a structure that looks like this? Well, when the crossbridges were first seen by Hugh Huxley, he mentioned, this was many, many years ago, roughly just after the time the theory was put forth, he said they look like something projecting out of the filaments at right angles. And I think that's what you see here. You can see it particularly well where in some cases the thick filaments are artificially spread out somewhat, and then they become clearer. And you can see, I don't know if you see what I see, but what I see are direct interconnections from one thick filament to the next thick filament. I don't see any evidence here of this angled arm with the two heads, but maybe you do. So question is, you know, I mean, this is what the pictures show. Here's another example. This is a longitudinal section, and again, I see the same thing. I see, it's like if you were to turn it 90 degrees, it would be like rungs of a ladder that you could climb, it looks like to me. And if you take a cross section, say right around here, it's what the cross section looks like. And you can see in some regions, not all, this is a very thin section, you can see the interconnections between the thick filaments. No thin filaments here, okay? So, one criticism of this method is that, I don't know how many of you have done electron microscopy, but you have to put it into a fixative, and there are a whole series of steps that need to be taken before you actually see this. So this has undergone some chemical transformations, and it might be that one of these transformations links one thick filament artifactually, one cross bridge artifactually to another, giving you this kind of structure, but the structure is not real. It's an effect of the fixation. So the way to test that is to quickly freeze a specimen and look at it. This is the freeze fracture technique. And although it doesn't have the resolution that we could see there. By the way, this is the Z line, and these are connecting filaments. The thin filaments have been chemically removed, and these are thick filaments here. And you can see between the thick filaments, you can still see in some places where it's well enough preserved, you can see these interconnections. So these electron micrographs, oh, by the way, Z is turned, it's not N, it's Z line. They have to look at right angles. So this is an issue because what we see differs from what the theory requires. I think this is what we see. So here you have one thick filament, another thick filament. Now a myosin molecule looks something like this with two heads attached. And the simplest interpretation of what we see is one head connected to another head and joined at the center, and it gives you approximately the right distance between the thick filaments. So it looks like this is actually a kind of rigidifying structure. You'd imagine, I mean, the muscle is an organ whose central feature is tension development, and you need something that holds together firmly during that tension development. And it's possible that this is at least, probably more, but at least a structural element to hold the lattice together so it doesn't fly apart in the face of huge forces. And so if you look at it in pseudo three dimensions, so you have one thick filament, these are all thick filaments, and the thick filaments seem to be interconnected by, I don't know if you'd say rigid or something, but by fixed interconnections. So where's the actin filament? Well, actin filament is right in between this triangle right here, running through this lattice. Okay, so the theory predicts one thing, but the evidence shows something quite different. So it's hard to imagine how something like this could actually work in the way that's been postulated. So there's some, I would say, rather fundamental disagreement between the predictions of the theory and what you can actually see. They don't agree. And there's one more I'll show you that I think is even more important than what I've shown you. And this is in the book that Walter showed. Okay. So now, beyond that, so the first part is what's wrong with the current theory. Then the question that you ask is, well, you know, if there's something wrong with the theory, so give me something to replace it. And I want to go there next and talk about the dynamics of contraction and what those dynamics imply for the mechanism, okay? And the theme that I'm going to present to you is the step size. Now, I think you'll see what I mean by step size in a moment, because that's a little vague. some of you who have read the literature know that the step size is sometimes taken as the rotation, the size of the rotation of the single cross bridge. But I'm thinking about this in a different context. And I'm going to show you that the step size is always a multiple of 2.7 nanometers, which is a dimension that shows up in the muscle. Okay. And this has something to do with the nature of the molecular contractile stroke. And I'm going to talk about where that stroke comes from. Okay. We did our first experiments were done with single isolated myofibrils. And the experiment is not very complicated. It's actually rather simple because the preparation is so simple. Every sarcomere is in series, and you don't have sarcomeres in parallel to confuse matter. So it's very straightforward. And you see we got a lot of sarcomeres here. At one end is a tension transducer, although it just looks like a blob. And at this side, you have a motor, which also looks like a kind of blob. And so we can take this end, and we can move it. We can allow it to stretch it or allow it to shorten. And these sarcomeres will follow suit. And here we can measure the tension during all of that. So it's a neat and tidy preparation. Beneath this preparation is a linear photodiode array. It's sort of like, you know, when you check out at the supermarket, it records those lines. It's very similar. It has many tiny elements in series. And so what you do is you project the light through this and onto this, and you can get a trace of the sarcomeres. It's very nice. So down here, you can see that this is position. And this is time. We'll get to what happens in a moment. But if you just look at the position, you can see here are the A band, I band, A band, and so on down here. And if we do an intensity scan, you get something that looks like this. So it actually, this arrow is backwards. This should be the darkest here and the lightest on this, but it doesn't matter. So these are A bands, you know, wide A bands containing the thick filaments. And this is the I band, and this is the Z line. So you have Z, Z, Z. And what we want to do is we want to measure the distance between these two Z lines during some experimental maneuver. And we can do it for one sarcomere if we like, because we have the information. Now, technologically, if you measure the distance between Z lines, you actually get a pretty noisy signal because you don't have much optical density here. But if you measure the centroid of this A band to the centroid of this A band, the signals are more robust and less noisy. It's the same thing. You're measuring the repeat spacing. So here's the experimental maneuver with time. And we start with the sarcomere doing nothing. You know, and then, remember, at the right side is a motor. So we activate the myofiber. We put it in an activating solution. And when it's in an activating solution, we stretch, and then we release. Actually, we stretch rapidly and release slowly, but that's just to make the signal collection easier. So if you're moving this motor in this direction, of course, all the sarcomeres, you can see them translating, right? Because, you know, you're taking this end and moving it away, so everything is kind of moving in this direction. And you can see that here because look at the A bands, they're moving this way. And then we release it slowly, and you can see them coming back to the original position. So this is an activating solution. So the muscle is trying hard, or the myofibril is trying hard. And what we want to do is measure the distance between the center of this A band and the center of this A band. And this is an algorithm that's developed to do that. So it measures the centroid of this one, and then centroid of this one. And each yellow line is tracking the centroid here. And we follow the centroid as a function of time. So we want to see what this looks like. And you can't see any sarcomere length change here because the entire change is maybe 1% or 0.5%. And you wouldn't be able to detect a 0.5% or 1% change of sarcomere length. All you see is the translation. But we tracked it. So, for example, we looked at the distance from here to here as a function of time. This is done automatically. And these are representative, parentheses, the best. They're not the best, but they're reasonably good results. So for these experiments, the first thing that happened is the sarcomere, the activated sarcomere, was allowed to shorten, right, and then restretched. And it looks very noisy. However, if you look carefully, for example, look at this one, you can see it goes down, and then it's stable, goes down, stable. So it looks like it's doing something like this. And we saw, and the same thing on the return, except it's noisier. You can see flat, 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 and so on. So we did some analysis of this, and of course we were at first greatly disappointed to find out that these vertical lines here, we thought the distance between here and here would be uniform throughout. You know, it would be step, step, and all the steps are the same. But you can see, obviously, here's a small one, and it's followed by a big one. So that was not the case. So that was our first disappointment. Anyway, we did this for many sarcomeres, many myofibrils, and here's the result. So this is the number of counts, and this is the step size, that is the vertical distance between the two flats. See, so we found that most of the distances are 5.4 nanometers between them. And we found many of them 2.7, which is half of this. So it looks like 2.7 is a kind of fundamental. So this is twice 2.7. And then we got 3 times 2.7 and 4 times 2.7. So it looked like each step was a multiple of some kind of quantum value, but nothing in between. Of course, there's something in between, but there's noise and such. And then next question that arose, well, you know, it, during active contraction, you see these steps. But what happens when you stretch out? Do you see the same steps? And this is another experiment that shows activated myofibril during shortening and during active stretching. And you can see that the results are pretty much the same. So it's n times 2.7, where n is an integer, both during the active shortening and actually during the restretch, during active restretch. So we thought this is interesting. Now, of course, a question arises. The first question that arises, well, you see n times 2.7 all the time, but your apparatus is a black box. And how do I know that your apparatus is not generating all of these 2.7 nanometer steps? So we tested that by looking at a passive myofibril to see if we got any steps or different size or whatever. We had no clue. And here's the result. So this is the active contraction, the darker one. We got 2.7, 2 times 2.7, 3 times 2.7, et cetera. And in the passive case, we also got steps, but the size is different. You can really make out the difference here and here. It's 2.3 nanometers instead of 2.7. So we know from that result that the analytical box that we have, or the person who's in charge, doesn't just generate 2.7 nanometer steps. These are natural, nothing to do with the apparatus. We tried many controls because this was, when we first published this result, I'm showing you the later experiments, but when we first published the result using more primitive techniques, we were roundly criticized by several groups, including Sir Andrew Huxley, saying it can't be true, it must be an artifact. And as a result, we developed, and finally, I think at the end, there were 6 or 7 different methods that we developed that showed the same result. And so these are an example of the kinds of controls that we did for artifact along the way, and it's all been published. So we had the photo dye array here and the myofibril, and we just translated back and forth to see if translation might, and we found not. As I said, it's all published in case anybody's interested in checking the results. We changed the magnification of the microscope to see, you know, different magnification, maybe 10 times more magnification will give you 27 nanometers instead of 2.7, and we didn't find that. We changed the processing algorithms, and no difference. We changed the analytical algorithms to take the individual step values and plot histograms, and same results. And we changed the experimenter, I did none of those. Other people in the laboratory, and the people kept changing along the way. And we also found that it was not just skeletal muscle that gave that result, but we tried honeybee flight muscle. Here's a picture. It's like it was printed by a machine. It's so beautiful and so regular. So that's at one end of the spectrum are these beautiful sarcomeres that you see here. And at the other end of the spectrum are the lousy ones, the cardiac muscle, and the sarcomeres there are not so beautiful. But we got the same result, whether we used frog skeletal muscle or we used honeybee flight muscle, a rabbit cardiac muscle, always n times 2.7 nanometers. So it looked as though sarcomere length chain steps are consistently n times 2.7 nanometers. Someone challenged us and said, hey, you know, you guys have done experiments with myofibrils. How about looking at a single thin and thick filament? And we thought this is going to be a formidable experiment until Xumei Liu, the Chinese postdoc from Tsinghua University, spent a full year trying to get it to work, and numerous technical problems, and finally she got it to work. All credit is due to her. So we have a preparation now with one thick filament and one thin filament, and of course the question is, well, you know, if you have the thin filament moving over the thick filament, you get 2.7 nanometer steps. And to do this, we developed something called nano levers, and these are simple levers that bend. It's like some of you know the atomic force microscope does something similar, but actually we had these before the AFM. We've now had these for quite a few years. So it's an etching process, a photo etching process, and what we want to do, and this is the result, by the way, a scanning electron micrograph, and this is diagrammatically. So we take a sheet, a silicon sheet, and we etch it, photo etch it, and this is what is left. So we find levers, long flexible levers. These are the most flexible because they're the most longest, the longest. And these are less flexible because they're shorter. And so we have an array of those. And these are really fat, and so they don't bend at all, practically stiff. And we use them as reference electrodes. So we take one of these, and you know, technically the way we do it is we leave a couple of these and we break away the ones that we don't want. And so this becomes a holding platform with two levers sticking out to which we can attach a filament. Okay, they're very fine and fragile. And so diagrammatically, this is what it looks like. If you just excuse me for a sec. I apologize, this is a complicated slide, but it's really pretty simple. So here's a thick filament, and here's a thin filament overlapping. And this is the end of, we call this a stationary lever. This is the thick lever that doesn't bend. And the end is expanded, and it runs down, and it runs all the way down here. And we have a photodiode array sitting beneath that records the optical pattern. And this is an actual recording of this dark region here. Okay, so the thick filament is stuck to that, and the other end of the thick filament projects out, overlaps the thin filament, which is then stuck to the deflectable, the fine deflectable lever. And again, this is a scan across this long long arm. Now this one seems irrelevant. It seems irrelevant to you, and it's irrelevant to, because it doesn't do anything, it just sits there. However, turns out to be important because, you know, we're subject to vibrations. Seattle is expecting a 9.1 earthquake, and you know, we get it wiggles all the time, and a bus comes by right outside our laboratory, and the laboratory shakes. So it turns out that if you measure the differential between these two, they both kind of wiggle together. You can, by taking the difference between these two, you can reduce the noise enormously. And that's really important because we're looking at very fine signals. But basically, what's going on is that as the actin filament moves in this direction, this lever bends, right? And then you can measure the length by measuring essentially the distance between here and here, and you have the signals to do that, refresh continuously over time. That's the main point. And so these are some of the kind of signals that we get. This is, I don't remember whether this one is shortening or lengthening, but this is the opposite here. And you can see that we've got the same pauses and steps. Pause, step, so on. And again, on both the moving in this direction and moving in this direction when activated. So we knew the steps were there, we could see them, and of course we're sitting at the edges of our seats waiting to see whether the size of these steps is going to be the same as the size of the steps that we measured with the myofibril, which is a large collection of these single filaments. And here's the result. So these are forward steps that would be, you might say, contraction. And these are the backward steps where you're getting this. And you can see that we've got 2.7 here, 5.4, 8.1, same result as we got. Technique is completely different. People are completely different. But the result is the same. We came upon a filter that's used by patch clamp people, a specially devised filter that can reduce the noise of the original signal without significantly blurring out the sharp transitions that occur. And we began doing that, unfortunately, and you can see the result. It's remarkable. You can see pause, step, and so on. And these are 2.7 nanometers apart from each other, so you can see that the pauses occur at distances of n times 2.7, just as we got, but the signal is so much clearer. Unfortunately, just when we developed these algorithms, our lab moved from one building to another, and the apparatus was never the same. So we couldn't continue these experiments. This is a very delicate apparatus, moved by people who are accustomed to moving pianos and beds and such. So. Now, there's another experiment published by a Japanese group, the group of Yanagida. This is Kitamura et al. And I want to show you their result because the result is very similar in a way. The experiment is different, but the result is consistent with what we've obtained. So here's a myosin molecule moving along an actin filament. And they measure the time course of movement. And so these are, from their paper, representative time courses. And you can see pause, step. And they made a histogram of the size of these steps. And they got 5.4 nanometers. That's the biggest peak that we see, 5.4, 2 times 2.7. So their result, while not the same as ours, it's certainly consistent with what we've found. So now, if you summarize the results, so if we look at single filament pairs, we got n times 2.7 nanometers, where n is an integer, and a single sarcomere, n times 2.7. And actually, I haven't shown you, but larger scale specimens show the same, although less clearly. And another group pretty much showing this big 5.4 nanometer peak. So it looks like we got something here that should be important in understanding how contraction occurs. And if you look at 2.7, it shows up again and again and again. So, you know, what's in a typical muscle, what's 2.7 nanometers? You'd think that there must be something in the muscle. It turns out that there is. If you look at the actin filament, the repeat is, as shown here, is 2.7 nanometers. So we have something cool. We have a dynamic that shows whether you do this or this, activated, it doesn't matter what kind of muscle, doesn't matter how big it is, you get n times 2.7 nanometers both during contraction and during active stretch. And there's a structure in the muscle that's 2.7 nanometers. And if you look at the X-ray diffraction pattern, you can see a very strong reflection at 2.7 nanometers. So you have dynamics and structure that are put together, and you think that, well, you know, we ought to be able to get somewhere. And it turns out even more correspondence. If you look at microtubules, I don't know how many of you know about microtubules. They're found in many cells, especially nerve cells. It's a kind of tubule that runs along. And here, the repeat spacing, let's say from here to here, is 8 nanometers. And if you look at the pattern of certain molecules, so-called motor molecules that move along, they jump at n times 8 nanometers. So again, there's a correspondence. In the actin filament, I showed you that the axial repeat is 2.7 nanometers, and the steps are n times 2.7. And in the microtubule, it's similar. Axial repeat is 8 nanometers, and the steps are n times 8 nanometers. So there's a similarity that lends confidence to all of these results. And microtubules are thought to be rather similar to actin filaments in terms of structure. So now, what does this tell us about the mechanism of contraction? Well, the conventional mechanism is... Walter, what time does this end?
The class is officially done at 10:15.
Okay, no problem.
We have the room till 11:30.
Yeah, well, okay. And it's fine. I thought it was at 10, so we're okay.
No, just...
10:15. Yeah. Okay. You guys will have to suffer through a few more minutes. Okay, so now here's the conventional theory, which you all know, and I ask you to think of how you can explain 2.7 nanometer steps, or the one step can be 2.7, the next one can be 4 times 2.7, and how this occurs also during active stretch. Considering that these are actually thought to be undergoing their stroke randomly, it's not so obvious how to accommodate that particular finding in here, or why they should be just 2.7 or 2 times 2.7 and the same in the reverse. So it's not just me challenging this particular theory, but other people along the way, the late Tatsuo Iwazumi, a brilliant guy and brilliant experimentalist, also brought other reasons why this theory was inadequate. There's a group from Princeton, Schutt and Lindbergh and Sweden, also raised questions, all of these from different angles and different points of view, and Oplotka and Israeli. So I'm not just a lone wolf crying in the wind. There are others, but most of these are no longer doing experiments because it's kind of hard to challenge authority and continue getting money to carry out experiments, as I think many of you know. So the unconventional way to approach this is to look at a diagram like this. So you have a thick filament and cross bridges. And remember, these cross bridges, according to the visual evidence that I've shown you, are just projections that stick out at fixed points along the filament. They don't undergo any kind of active stroke or anything. And here's the thin filament, thin filament with a repeat of 2.7, right? And we know that the thin filament binds to the thick filament. So if you were to stretch the sarcomere, which means pulling this in this direction, then the distance, it's going to settle after you pull a bit. It's not this black actin that sticks to the crossbridge anymore. It might be this one or this one or this one. And that would give you n times 2.7 during active stretch. So then the question is, well, what happens in this direction? It's kind of the same, but where's the propulsive action? How do you get active shortening? And a suggestion is here as to how you can do it. So here's the Z line, right? And again, the thick filament and the actin filament. Now, if the actin filament itself were to undergo some conformational change that, say, starts here, so it undergoes, it shortens. I've shown shortening as a kind of loop just because it's visually, but some kind of conformational change starts here, moves the Z line this way, and then propagates along here, and will settle, of course, on one of these red dots. We don't know which one. It could be the next one, and so on. So the step size in this case would be either 2.7 or 2 times 2.7 or 3 times 2.7, et cetera. And then another wave comes and advances some more and some more and some more. So it's like a snake moving along and advancing like this, little by little. And for every one of these waves that travels, the actin filament advances a little bit, one more notch, and that therefore you get a lot of shortening, or as much shortening as can be permitted. So the question is, well, okay, that's a nice model. It absolutely fits the dynamics, but is it true? You can never prove anything to be true, but there are a few requirements that we can see if they're satisfied. So this suggests that there's got to be a local structural change in actin. And the structural change needs to propagate among the actin. So the question you might be asking is, well, you know, what's the evidence for all of this stuff? By the way, these two together would be equivalent to a propagating phase transition, and the physical chemist would put it in those terms. Now, what about the first one, the structural change in actin? So I don't need to go into detail on these, but look at the numbers. They're mostly, these are Japanese groups, 15% change in length of actin, 15%, 17%, 15%. And this one, it's not so clear, but shows some kind of change. So yeah, there is evidence. If you look in the literature, you can find evidence for some kind of structural change or shortening along the actin filament. And does it propagate? Well, you can look at these actin filaments in the so-called in vitro motility assay, and you can kind of see them sort of snaking along as they go. They're not rigid rods. And this is not evidence, but it's certainly consistent with that possibility. But these kinds of experiments were examined in detail by a Japanese group, Hattori et al. And what they did was they put markers along the actin filament to see what happened, because you can easily image the markers better than you can image the filament. And they found that if the filament was moving this way, that the first thing that happened was that the distance between these two diminished. In other words, there was some kind of local shortening. And then the distance between these two diminished, and so on down the line. And so they reported that there was a kind of a propagating phase transition along the actin filament. And so we come back to this, and I would suggest to you that this is a very reasonable model, the propagating phase transition again and again along the actin filament that fits the dynamic data that I showed you earlier. So you'd think that, okay, you know, it looks like, if I believe the results that this guy has shown, it looks like maybe he nailed it. But we can't stop there. And so, you know, the whole world is pointing this way, but sometimes you notice something that points in the opposite direction, and you got to pay attention to it. And there is such. And so I want to tell you that there's another aspect of contraction that I believe is complementary to the first. And let me explain why I think so. So having had this nice apparatus, we decided to look at thick filaments, single thick filaments. And this shows you how we do it. So again, we're using these nano levers. And this is a stationary beam. Doesn't bend because it's really rigid, connected down here. And then we have a deflectable lever. And you remember, they come in pairs, right? So we have one here, and these come down to a bar at the bottom that holds them together. And this is just a reference that we use to reduce the noise. We compare these two together, and we get a less noisy signal. So, but basically, we want to see what happens to the distance between this if we either put tension on it or release the tension. And the way we do that is we have a motor right at the bottom at that joining piece, and we take the motor, and we can move both of these levers in this position, this way or this way. Okay. Now, if you think about this lever, it's connected to the thick filament, but remember, it's bendable. So if we move this in this direction, the motor doesn't necessarily reflect the length of this filament, because this is bendable. See, if you put more tension on it, it moves this way, and less tension, it moves this way. So you need to take that into account in what I'm going to show next. So we're going to take the motor and move it in this direction. Okay. So this is time, and this is length or position. Now the gray one here shows the motor movement, right? So no movement here, and then it moves to stretch, right? And then it holds it, and then it comes down again. So as as this lever is moving this way, of course, the filament does stretch, but remember, it doesn't necessarily follow the motor. Well, at first it does kind of, because you can see that the distance between here and here, that's plotted, that's the noisier one, is following it. But then you stop. But when you stop, there's a lot of tension that's still on the filament, and the filament response looks like this. And then you go back again, and the response looks like this. So they kind of reflect each other, but not exactly. So what we could do, we want to analyze to see what the length. First of all, you don't expect the filament to change length at all, because we were all taught that the thick filament is essentially a rigid rod. But it does change length, you can see here. So we thought to analyze to see if there are steps in length. And this looks like noise, so you can't really tell. However, in this phase, it's a little easier to look at because there's no motor movement. When you're moving the motor, you're introducing noise. So although this looks noisier, it turns out to be easier to measure here instead of here or here. So that's what we did. And this is now spread out vertically. So what you can see is pause, 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 and so on. So apparently there are step-like motions in the length of the filament. And there it is again, 2.7, n times 2.7. One of these is stretching the filament, and the other is releasing the filament. So the thick filament is actually shortening. It's not supposed to do that, but you can see that it does that. And the steps are n times 2.7 both ways. So you're starting to think that, hey, you know, it just can't be because everything is 2.7, so got to be something wrong with the apparatus, or the experimentalist is crazy or on a drug or something like that. You know, so we did more controls here because it just, you know, too many 2.7s. So the first control is to put a magnifier, an extra lens in the microscope to see, you know, what happened. And the result was the same as before. It didn't make any difference. It's still n times 2.7. And then we did automatic analysis of the steps. So the step analysis that I showed you earlier was done semi-automatically. You take a trace, and the trace looks like it's got, you know, steps. And it's up to the experimentalist to put a point at the beginning and the end of each pause. Now, the experimentalist has no scale next to him or her, so it doesn't know, you know, what's the right size to get, so there should be no bias. But we tried to do it completely automatically so that there's no possibility of human error. And here's the result. It should be 2.7, 5.4, 8.3. And it's not as nice because the machine doesn't do as well as you do, but basically the result is confirmed. It's the same size. We tried some other specimen, silk. And some of you may know that there have been experiments on silk. And it turns out silk does the same thing. When you take silk and you stretch it or release it, it does it in steps. And they've been reported, and the steps are n times 14 nanometers, 14, 28, and so on. So we put a piece of silk in our apparatus, and we could find 14, 28, and so on. However, we have more resolution than the papers that have been produced, and so we can also see 7, 21. So it's actually not n times 14, but n times 7 in silk. But anyway, there's no n times 2.7 that you see here. So all of these controls show that the 2.7 nanometers is not an artifact of our apparatus. So it looks like thick filaments change length in steps of n times 2.7 nanometers, and by now you're getting sick of that number. So here's a kind of summary. We got thick filament changing length. It's not supposed to change length, right? N times 2.7. The whole contractile system in myofibrils and filaments, n times 2.7. So it throws a kind of, you might say, a monkey wrench into the equation, because we already derived a model consistent with this. But now we're hearing that the thick filament not only can change length, but can change length at the same interval as the whole sarcomere. And so the question that arises naturally are thick filament length changes. And sarcomere length change is linked in some way. It seems kind of natural. Or to put it another way, does the thick filament shortening, which you've never heard of before, does the thick filament shortening contribute to the sarcomere shortening? Well, of course, they're in series, you know, so it's not unbelievable that the thick filament is shortening and therefore the whole sarcomere is shortening. Now, you've heard that thick filaments don't change length, right? Thick filaments are rigid rods. And the I guess the best evidence is shown here. These are electron micrographs taken by Hugh Huxley two generations ago, and they still appear in some of the textbooks, and you can see that the A band running from here to here, or the thick filaments which run from here to here, there's no difference whether you have a long sarcomere or a short sarcomere. So after the sarcomere has contracted, the thick filaments are pretty much the same length as for the longer uncontracted sarcomere. And the corresponding diagram is here. And the most important thing is that the thick filaments remain at constant length. So that's one piece of evidence. There are other pieces of evidence, and you don't see these in the textbook. So this is from a Russian group. This is from the laboratory of a guy named Gleb Frank, who was the premier biophysicist in Russia 50 years ago, 40 years ago. And of course, they also did electron microscopy on frog sartorius muscle. And this is the relaxed muscle, and this is the activated. And by the way, these are microspheres put in both cases to make sure that there's no systematic magnification error. You can see that this one and this one are the same size. So it's not an error due to magnification. So here's the thick filament in the relaxed state, and here's the thick filament in the contracted state. You can see 10, 15, 20% shortening. But that's not the only result. Here's another one. This is a limulus muscle, and the sarcomeres are, I think, roughly 10 microns instead of 2 microns. So you have now a lot more resolution of the microscope. So the thick filament runs from here to here in the relaxed state, and you can see that in the contracted state, it's shorter. And what he did also is to extract filaments from relaxed state and from the activated state, and you can see that they've shortened considerably. And in this case, isolated thick filaments were taken in the relaxed solution, activating solution, relaxed solution. You can see the same thing. So the question is, okay, you've got evidence that shows no sarcomere, no thick filament shortening, and evidence that shows thick filament shortening. Which one do I believe? And I think for the serious person, you need to look at the original experiments and see which ones were done carefully and which ones were not. But I made a chart prepared for that book that lists. So this is the maximum amount of either A-band or thick filament, same thing, shortening that occurs. And I put them in four categories. No change, that is, you know, less than 5%. Small change, medium-sized change, large change. And here is for invertebrate specimens and for vertebrate specimens. And look at the numbers. It seems hard to argue that there's no evidence for thick filament length change, because there's a lot of evidence for thick filament length change. So, and the length change that we saw is N times 2.7 nanometers. And there is a repeat along the thick filament, molecular repeat, that is 2.7 nanometers, or 5.4. So, and this is when we were doing these experiments, this was a kind of daily, I'm showing you the result of a daily kind of observation, cardiac myofibrils. This is the relaxed state, some shortening and more active shortening. And if you look at the A band here, it's 1.44. Microns, and here you can see that it's narrower than here, and here it's 1.07. So these are, you know, rather standard everyday observations in our laboratory. And the one that we started and unfortunately never got finished was taking a thick filament between a lever and a fixed point and subjecting it to an activating solution. It shortens. And here's a typical time course of shortening. Again, these arrows point to pauses here, 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 and so on. And this is the ultimate result, but unfortunately, we don't have enough data, but these are the counts from the few experiments that we were able to do, and this one falls at roughly 2.7, 2 times 2.7, 3 times 2.7, active contraction, see, of a single thick filament. So now the question is, well, how on earth can the thick filament actually shorten? I mean, we think of it as just as a rigid rod, but it's not rigid. But what could drive it to shortening? And the idea or the evidence came from a guy named Bill Harrington at Johns Hopkins University. And he demonstrated that, you know, this is a myosin rod along here, and he demonstrated that the rod can undergo an alpha helix to coil, random coil configuration. It's kind of like you take a wool sweater and you put it in a hot washer or a hot dryer and it shrinks. That's this kind of transition. In the case of wool, it's irreversible, but in the case of these filaments, it is reversible. So that was his idea as to how you could get thick filament shortening. And you can see some evidence. These are isolated myosin filaments, and some of them, under the conditions in which you'd expect some shortening. And you can see, for example, in this one-third of the way or so along the rod, you can see this clump. You can see the same thing here and here. It's a region that actually undergoes shortening. And so how you can imagine that the thick filament could shorten is diagrammed here. So here's the center of the thick filament, the M region here. And this represents, just schematically, one myosin. Of course, there are two heads, but this one is linked to this point. And so if this region here undergoes a helix to coil transition and shortens, and by the way, this is a length tension diagram of the elastic properties of this. So this is shortening. So as it's shortening, it exerts tension, right? And since this one is connected to this one, as this shortens, it drives this rod in this direction. So this one is going to go this way, and the position of this one will move in this direction. So effectively, that half thick filament will shorten. And you can imagine the same on the other half. It will shorten too. And it will shorten in steps. And the size of the step can be determined because on this rod are alternating charges, plus, minus, plus, minus. Same thing here. So in order to hold it together, the minus from this one will line up with the plus from this one and so on. And so if you want to move it in this direction, it's going to move by increments of this spacing because always you need a minus to stick to a plus. So it's going to move by, and this spacing is 4.1 nanometers, so it's going to move by increments of 4.1, either 1 times 4.1 or 2 times 4.1, depending on the strength of the chain. So it's always 4.1, not 2.7. So how do we get 2.7? Well, 2.7 comes naturally if you think about the structure of the thick filament. So thick filament consists of three subfilaments like this. Now, if the change occurs one at a time, for example, first in this subfilament, then this one, then this one, then it keeps going round and round. Every event, this one is going to shorten by 4.1 nanometers, this zero and this zero, right? And so the end of the thick filament will shorten by one-third of 4.1 because you've got two zeros and one 4.1. So that gives this number. If the same thing happens on the other side, then multiply by 2 and you get 2.7 nanometers. So the numerology with certain assumptions works. You can get 2.7 nanometer shortening out of this. So the kind of contractile mechanism that we're talking about regarding the thick filament is it's not that the entire thick filament shortens uniformly. It shortens in segments, first this one and this one and this one, and with every one of these shortenings, you get a 2.7 nanometer sarcomere length shortening. So I'll skip this because you're not interested in X-ray data. So what do these many 2.7 nanometer steps imply? Well, the first thing is that, you know, we've seen this over a period of actually 15 years or so developing. I think we have six or so different techniques showing the same result. And it kept getting higher and higher resolution as we were doing these experiments. But it would be nice to see another laboratory repeat these experiments and hopefully get similar results. That's step one. And step two, I think, is that if it can be repeated in other laboratories, then I think the lever arm model needs re-evaluation, or the cross-bridge model, because I've given you examples of four or so different fundamental aspects that that theory doesn't explain. That I think that perhaps for me the most important one being the stepwise shortening and the length changes of filaments that come with it. But still, and this is sort of the end, we're left with two options. You know, I brought to you two different mechanisms. The first half, I talked about this one where the actin is snaking its way along. And then I talked about the thick filament one, where the thick filament itself was shortening and thereby bringing about shortening of the sarcomere. So which one is right? And both of these, I think, are correct. And I think each one applies in a different situation. So I should say that they're not essentially different. They're both protein phase transitions, also involving the water, but I haven't talked about that here. They're phase transitions, and these phase transitions are known in physical chemistry. It involves the solid, the protein, and the solvent around. Massive change, it occurs. And here it occurs in the myosin, and here it occurs in the actin, right? And so philosophically, the two mechanisms are actually rather similar. I think that this one, see, actin is in every cell in your body. It's a primitive mechanism. And with this mechanism, you can get huge length changes because you get, you know, one snake, one after another, and they can add up to give you very big changes. But they're not developed to give you those changes against high tensions. To do that, nature has developed muscles. And muscles contain myosin filaments. And so this one has been shown, actually, through some experiments, it can generate a tension that's three, four times as much as this. So muscles are special for having developed this kind of ability to lift loads against, to lift big loads, right? And this can't do it. So the muscles use both of these in cases where you're trying to lift no load or very small load. This one gives you big shortenings, no problem at all. But this one can't. Whoops. But when you face a higher load, if you're lifting someone like myself, then you have to use this mechanism to be able to do it. So I think, and finally, I got to say that these studies were done by a group of, you know, extremely talented people, both on the experimental side and also in terms of the equipment, because, you know, I think the equipment is amazing to be able to do that. And I'll stop by saying there's one book there. There's another book in 2002 that actually deals with water inside of cells and the role of water. And there's a chapter on muscle. And the chapter on muscle deals with pretty much what I've told you, but also explains how water may be involved as well. You know, water is the prime ingredient of muscles. Two-thirds of your muscles are water, and every theory that you ever heard about ignores the water and considers that two-thirds of your volume of your muscle don't do anything, and I think that's not true. And this discusses the evidence that there's a role in not only in muscle, but in other cells in your body, and that without the water, you don't function. That's why I keep drinking this stuff. And more recently, about 2.5 years ago, this book came out, and this book deals with more fundamentally with water, not only in your body, but also water around us. And it demonstrates that, you know, we've learned that water has three phases: the solid, liquid, and vapor. This book describes a fourth phase that's not only in between solid and liquid, but also it's the phase that fills most of your body. It's this kind of water that we and it has really interesting properties. It's charged, negatively charged, and it responds to light. And it may be related to Emoto. I think you're interested in. Maybe not. You showed a picture some years ago. Okay, anyway, I think I'll stop here. I'm sorry I went over. Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Jerry. The class is officially over. So you know, people are in class. If you want to leave, please feel free to leave. But I think, can I assume, Jerry, that you're happy to stay a little bit longer and answer some questions if they ask some questions?
Delighted. Yeah, $50 a question.
Yeah, sure. So if there are any questions that you'd like to ask, please feel free to do so.
Answers cost extra. Please.
So if the acting shortens the changing length, that means the number of these. Let's assume you have 10 surgeons in one field.
10 what?
10 surgeons, the molecules that you have shown it. It changes and has now 11 or 9. It changes, you said, 2.7.
Well, it's not that you're adding, unless I misunderstood. It's not that you're adding new actins to it. It's that the entire actin filament, the same number of actin monomers, is shortening locally, shortening, and this is propagating just like a snake. It's propagating along the filament. That wasn't clear, I guess. Just like a snake would move. You know, you have the snake is lying on the grass, and then it starts from one end, and the snake will sort of curl up like that, and this curl will propagate along the snake, and the snake will move an increment, and then same thing happens again, it moves another increment, and so on. It keeps going indefinitely.
But in your drawing, option two.
Oh, option two, yeah.
The middle example had more circles than the upper
exam. Oh, if it did, I'm sorry. It was an accident. I didn't mean that. No, the number is not changing, but some local region in the actin can contract. I drew it as a loop, but actually it's probably more like a contraction.
So the number of elements are the same, but
right.
They contract locally.
Right, yeah, and the contraction propagates. Please.
Measuring the 2.7 nanometer seems to be really impressive. So how do you are able to differentiate between 2.7, 2.75, 2.3 nanometer? Then my next question, what is then your resolution?
Well, you saw the resolution based on the traces. It's hard to say what the resolution is. We did some experiments in that, and we found a resolution that we could actually detect changes on the order of 0.3 or 0.2 nanometers.
Because you have 2.75 nanometers.
Oh yeah,
so that's 0.05.
No, that was, it was just that the postdoc who did the experiments thought 2.75 increments of 0.25 were nice to draw on there, but it didn't necessarily mean that the value was 2.75. It was just the grid that was at 2.75. Well, no, but the steps are done completely. This is just a picture. Steps are done independent of the picture.
So how would we have able then to measure 2.75?
Well, we measure, so we take a line of steps that, you know, looks like this, but has noise, and then you, the human marks the beginning of the pause and the end of the pause, and beginning and end, and so on. I said, also, we did it automatically with a similar result, but the typical way to do it is you put markers, points at the beginning and the end, but you have no idea of the scale. And then the computer takes over, it plots the best pause, the best fit between those two points and the actual data, because the data is noisy, and the next one, and the next one. And then it computes the spacing between those. And from all of those computations, from, you know, hundreds or thousands of those steps, it was done automatically. Yeah. You had a question?
Yeah, I do have a question. So you show the experiments using Hilleman and Hilleman.
Yeah.
The experiments done by
Schumann.
Yes.
Schumann.
Can you label the active filament so that you can test directly the hypothesis of your problem to see if there's a step?
Well, yeah. See, that was already done by a Japanese group. I had one slide and went over it very quickly. They put markers along the actin filament, right? So they have this actin filament, and they have put a bead or a marker here, 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 and they track the distance between those markers as the filament moved along. And they found that there was a propagation, that the distance between these two markers decreased, then between these two markers, then between these two markers, and so on. And they concluded that it was a propagating, basically, length change or phase transition as the actin was proceeding along.
But was that done on the single myosin head or the big pH?
It was done in the in vitro motility assay where there are myosin heads planted on the surface like leaves of grass. And then actin filaments were unleashed and allowed with ATP to crawl along. So this has become a kind of standard mechanism that people have used to do experiments on actin-myosin interaction. It's just that that group was the only one that I know of who have done that experiment. It's a good experiment to do again.
Do you think it would be different if you have a
Yeah, if I have to predict, I would say no, but, you know, the experiment needs to be done. You should do it.
So based on the two potential mechanisms, which one do you think lines up better, or do they line up at all with the energetics of how muscles work?
It's a good question. It's not a simple question to answer. The first issue is, you know, how does the cross-bridge theory line up with energetics? And there's a problem. The problem was discussed in my muscle book. The problem has never been resolved. And one of the issues is that nobody takes into account entropy changes. So if you go from order to disorder, the entropy increases. And if you start contraction with an ordered system, and it becomes more disordered, which is suggested by these length changes, especially tick filament length changes. You know, you start with an ordered tick filament, and as it contracts, it gets progressively disordered because of these transitions from an alpha helix to a random coil. See, none of the interpretations of energetics take into account this entropy change during contraction. So, now I don't know if you could do it with this model, because nobody's ever done it, but that would be the first thing that one would need to do, because if entropy changes, that has to be taken into account in terms of the energetics. We assume, or most of us assume, that the cross-bridge cycles. It goes from the original position to the same position at the end of the cycle, or at the end of the contraction. So there's no change of entropy. But the thick filament length changes that have been demonstrated show that you go from order to disorder. Someone needs to take that into account and then to see whether this new formulation or the old formulation actually fits. So the answer is, I'm not sure.
Thank you.
But I think it might fit because here you take into account order to disorder. There's an unexplained energy that people have been talking about in the muscle field that nobody has actually resolved so far. Perhaps the entropy will take account of that. Not sure. Yeah?
So it seems like whether you are testing actin, myosin, or silk, you are getting signals in steps.
Yeah.
It would be interesting to see if you take like some elastic material that we know is linear behavior and see whether you will also get a signal that you present steps.
Well, how do we know that it's linear behavior? You see, one would have thought, take silk, for example, and take silk and stretch it. It looks like linear behavior until somebody made measurements and with high sensitivity and found out it's not. It's actually step-like. And this is a kind of characteristic of proteins that you might, you know, they're held together and suddenly they give or something, or they go through a new configuration. They undergo some conformational change from one to another, and you expect that might happen in a step. So it's actually more natural for proteins or protein-water combination to do that than it is to not do that. If you have enough sensitivity to detect these very tiny length changes.
Yeah, but the idea is that you can use maybe like some method or something to just rule out any possibility that the system is generating step things. Because maybe you just have the photodiodes and they are like aligned in steps, or maybe because of the stepper model or some noise, that you would always, if you will always end up getting steps even like with a method or something, then it might be just system.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this was the reason for all the controls that we carried out. For example, showing that silk gives different size steps, the passive muscle gives different size steps. You know, we did exactly the same experiment with passive muscle, active muscle. They both show steps, but the size is different. See, so you know, on that basis, it looks as though the steps are real, and yeah, I mean, we tried experiment. We started actually on whole skeletal muscles, and you can see evidence of steps. We analyzed them. At the time this book was written, we suggested it looks like 2.7 nanometers, but we didn't have enough resolution. So with each technique that we used, improved techniques, every 3 years or so we had a new technique because we were challenged, because muscle can't work that way, but you know, we found it. And so we went to progressively more sensitive methods with higher resolution. We kept getting the same results, only more clearly. So I think, you know, given the fact that many different methods have been used and with the controls, if there's an artifact, we haven't been able to find it. And the fact that it corresponds to a molecular dimension makes it even more likely. Yep.
If I understood well, one of the criticism for the previous model was that there was the correlation between the tension and the overlap, so linked to the length of the fiber. What are the predictions of this new model, and could a combination of those two mechanisms, so the shortening of the myosin and the smoothing of the acting of the thick filament account for this discrepancy that with the previous model?
Yeah, I mean, I can't stand here and argue. However, that's in the book. It took basically a whole book to go over a list of mechanical and energetic predictions that could be explained by these phenomena. So, I'm sorry, but it's really hard for me to wave my hands and argue. Yeah.
Just to follow up, but is overlap required at all, or beyond if overlap, where is the cutoff point? Is there a cutoff point?
Well, yeah, there is a cutoff point, but it depends on who does the experiment. So, I showed six different experiments, and on the left side was to scale roughly what the cutoff points were. I can't tell you the exact sarcomere length. In different systems have big sarcomeres or small sarcomeres, so the absolute length chains. But typically, in the four at the bottom, we're talking about sarcomere lengths that are 10 or 20% longer than what you expect.
And according to
the model? Well, see, now it takes into account, you need to separate through the first as a test of the crossbridge theory. That's the first point. And crossbridge theory can't explain that. You must have something else. So a question, and I know there's evidence from this group here about the connecting filaments. It's possible that connecting filaments contribute to contraction. Now, most people presume these are just elastic filaments that allow the sarcomere to return to its natural length. But you know, when you activate the sarcomere, those filaments are capable of shortening. And it seems very natural. The thick filament is capable of shortening, and these connecting filaments are in series. Why not, if you're Mother Nature, why not allow those filaments to contribute as well? No reason not to. So then you need to be distinguished about what you're testing and what you're checking. Crossbridge theory doesn't work. That theory, if you take account of that possibility, could work.
Can we isolate thick filament? Why not do the skin with the microscope and then isolate the thick filament to see if there's a bias in the head that is connected?
Could be done, I think. But, I apologize. We stopped doing experiments on mussels some years ago, mainly because the apparatus could never be, this highly sensitive apparatus could never be put back together again. And we began studying water. And so we're not doing it, but sure, other people could do it. But, I would challenge you or anybody to look in the literature. There are plenty of electron micrographs that were taken, especially 30 or 40 years ago. Look at that. And I would challenge you to find even one example of a crossbridge that looks like the one that we see in diagrams all the time. It's really hard to find.
So, Jerry.
I think I've exhausted that.
No, I've lost it. Just kind of like a follow-up. Like, when Venus was arguing, beyond filament overlap, and we showed some examples where other people have found active tension to decrease or to become zero, and it's beyond overlap. But if you had...
Well, no, I showed four examples and not.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But...
No, we assume that, but the experiments are different.
The experiments show, I thought they found at a length that was way beyond that only then active tension finished.
Right, that's what... Right, so...
Okay.
So,
but if the thick filament was short because it was contributing to force, then you would assume that you should get, you should be able to get force or contraction independent of sarcomere length.
But you could get, depending on, and the actin filament needs something to attach to. So if the actin filament could attach to the connecting filament, then it's possible. But we don't know how much force could be generated in a situation like that. And that would need to be studied.
Hold on. Has anyone ever looked at thick filament shortening as a function of sarcomere length? Would it shorten less in very long sarcomere lengths than its shorter sarcomere lengths when it's activated?
I don't think that anybody specifically asked that question. No, got to remember, people doing experiments under the framework where thick filament shortening is not permitted. And so many of the experiments were not done in a highly systematic manner to see what happens at a series of sarcomere lengths. Mostly they just did experiments and they showed that, under the conditions, particular conditions, they showed the long sarcomere and the short sarcomere, and they showed that the thick filament or the ABAM shortening. That needs to be done, but it takes a bold group to do an experiment like that, because you submit it to a journal and the first reaction is, well, what are you talking about? We all know that thick filaments don't shorten, therefore your experiments must be erroneous. They can't be right. So I think the answer is, I don't know that anybody who's done that. But if you're interested in the question, you know, there's a list of all the papers in that book or in the review article that I wrote, and it's possible for anybody to go back and take a look. It's illuminating, I gotta tell you, to look at all those papers that show thick filament shortening. It's like if you came from Mars and settled in Calgary, you know, you're an alien, and you want to know about thick filaments, and you read the literature, and then you read the textbook, you find a disconnect between the two.
Just a comment to that, you know, as you may or may not know, we have looked at Amen Shortly and Maria Yamamoto at one point presented at the Biophysical Society.
Yeah.
And I think, I mean, we found very, very clear A-band shortening, but it doesn't seem to happen that you activate the myofibril if the A-band is shortening. But if you wait minutes, if you wait 2-3 minutes, then it's clearly there. So I think the question, for us at least, was not so much, is there A-band shortening or not? But rather, I am convinced there is if you wait long enough. But the question then becomes, is it physiologically significant? Is it part of the contractile mechanism? Because it seems to occur, you know, at a much slower time frame than, when you move around and you walk, and you activate a muscle for half a second, then you release it and activate it again every step. It seems in a situation like that, it probably would not really contribute.
It could be. So one of the issues is that, you know, I'm not sure of exactly what the conditions are, but if the sarcomere is being held under high enough tension, then the thick filament may be trying to shorten, but can't shorten very much. And so one would need to know the particular conditions, but you could absolutely be absolutely right. But I point to the famous study of Gordon, Huxley, and Julian, and the length tension study, and they also looked to see, I think it was in that paper, looked to see what happened to A-bands. Huxley and Niedergerke, one of the very old papers that was actually responsible for the sliding filament theory, they found thick filament, they found A-band shortening, and they dismissed it as an optical artifact. But they found their A-band shortening occurred quickly. It was, they saw it. And they dismissed it, and we followed up using a higher sensitivity method, a different optical technique, and we could reproduce their result, but we argued that this was not the result of an optical artifact because we used a different method and got the same result. So even if you reread the study that was actually responsible for the introduction of the sliding filament theory, if you read it carefully and look at it, you'll see evidence that doesn't fit, but they argued it away.
Well, they say that at short sarcomere lengths, there's about a 0.1 micron shorting that they see, and so that would be about 7%. And then yes, they say, well, that's kind of within the resolution. But interestingly enough, they said when there were longer sarcomere lengths, they didn't see that shorting, which again was consistent with Maria's result that in rabbit psoas, when we held it, I think it was about 2.7 or 2.8 microns or longer, and we then didn't find any shortening even if we waited for minutes.
Yeah.
But if it was smaller than a certain length, I think 2.7 microns or so, then we found a shortening that developed. So kind of,
that's interesting.
Kind
yeah.
of consistent with that. Completely different question if nobody else is wondering.
Yeah, if
just
you don't mind,
one.
I'm going to sit down.
Yeah, sit down, yeah. Just, one of the things, not if you do the single myofilament results, but if you do the myofibril results, you know, then you have several hundred myosins and twice as many actins and
filaments.
And so if you then see a stepwise shortening, then that would mean, presumably, that all these steps, all these 800 or 1,000 actins, we have to be coordinated.
It's more serious than that because we saw the steps in whole muscles when we started, and then we saw the steps in whole cells. We kept going down, 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 but you could find the steps. So the coordination is much more extensive even than you imply. And that's a question that, you know, was scratching our heads trying to figure out how is it possible that they could all be coordinated. And finally, the hypothesis that we've come to is that it's actually the water that undergoes a transition from one state to another state. Now, we don't think of water undergoing transition from one state to another state, but this is what we showed experimentally in the past decade or so, that this fourth phase of water that's ordered, it's semi-crystalline, and that phase can undergo a transition very quickly from one state to another. And if this happens, it propagates very rapidly. So if this happens in the muscle, you can imagine that if this transition is somehow related to the protein transition that's responsible for the shortening, this could propagate over long distances in very short times. So that's our hypothesis right now. We don't know if it's valid. It needs further testing. But we also found that recently we did experiments using nuclear magnetic resonance on muscles, and one of my students found that if you look at the uncontracted versus the contracted, the signal changed radically. That in the uncontracted, in the relaxed muscle, the water was more ordered, and in the contracted muscle, it was more disordered. But this was measured only in two states, and I think it's necessary to be able to follow the time course and see what happens. But that's our hypothesis. Yeah, we were totally astonished because of the point that you make, that the coordination, the propagation needs to be so quick.
But if let's assume it really is all perfectly coordinated, and your basic incremental acting step is 2.7 nanometers, since you measure from century to century of A band, then you would assume that you never measure 2.7 nanometers, but only 5.4, because you would always measure a step on the one side of the Z line and on the other side.
Yeah, it depends on the extent of coordination, whether the two are occurring at the same time or not, and we don't know for sure whether that's the case. Yeah, it depends. Yeah, right. Unresolved. Good question. Yeah.
Any other final questions?
No, please.
Could you explain your idea with water?
Idea and what?
The idea with the water, the function of the water, and the four phase. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Yeah, sure. Our cells are filled with water, so you know everybody knows that we're, depending on your age, and when you're born, you're 90% water, and when you get to have gray hair, you're down to 65% water. We become dehydrated with time. That's why I've been drinking a lot. And so the question is, well, what kind of water is inside your cells? And we think it's just like, you know, water, like a glass of water. But there have been a lot of studies for a century demonstrating that the water inside our cells is actually ordered. It's more like a crystal. And that's why the water is gel-like inside of our cells. It's not a liquid. So if you take a muscle cell, as I know some of you have done, and you cut it, you might expect that, of course, you're cutting the membrane, you might expect that if it's a liquid, that the water would just leave, you know, like turn on a faucet, but it doesn't happen that way. The water, except for the region of the injury, the water tends to stay in the muscle because it's gel-like. And we found that gel-like water is this fourth phase of water that's like a crystal, and the molecules stick tenaciously to one another. And so we found that inside the muscle, just like inside every cell, if the cell is in the quiescent state, like in the case of muscle, the default state, or the quiescent state is a relaxed muscle, we found that the water is actually this kind of fourth phase organized water. And then when it contracts, it undergoes a phase transition, it's not just the water, it's the water together with the protein, because this water is stuck onto protein. So you know, here's a protein, and we all know that proteins fold from this configuration or whatever. But the proteins fold with the interfacial water around it. It's one and the same unit. The proteins don't operate in a vacuum. They operate in a milieu that contains this kind of ordered water. And that's the unit. It's the protein plus the water. And so depending on what happens to this organized water, the motions of the protein or the folding depend very much on what happens to the water. So you can't have the water remain exactly as it is and the protein do this. The two undergo together. And so the phase transition or the conformational change is actually a change not only in the protein but also in the water. Now, I showed it at the protein, but you need to take into account the water. So the 2001 book provides evidence that all of the major cell processes that go on, it's not just contraction, but secretion, cell division, all of these involve not only transitions in proteins, but also the water that surrounds the proteins. So this transition from the ordered fourth phase water to ordinary water is central to everything that goes on in your cells. That's the main message in this book, and a lot of evidence is provided. So now we find even more evidence, which for some people may sit uncomfortably, and that is, you know, all the cells have negative charge, right? So you put your electrode into a cell and you measure minus 80 millivolts or whatever. And we all think and believe that this somehow comes from the channels and the pumps and whatever. And I think that may not be true. I think it may actually come mostly from the water, because this fourth phase of water actually bears negative charge. It's not neutral. And I'm sorry, I don't have the evidence at hand to show you, but it's one of the major characteristics. When this water forms, it forms next to hydrophilic interfaces. And the water is this fourth phase water is negative, and the water beyond it is positive. It's like a battery, and we can actually get electrical current from this battery. Even have a patent on getting it. You get it from the light energy that's absorbed by the water, separates the charge into this negative and positive. So if the cell, muscle cells, any cells, if the cell is filled with this kind of water, this water adds negative charge to the inside of the cell. And the question is, well, is it possible that the negative charge of the cell, which everybody can measure with a microelectrode, is it possible that this comes as a result of the water that's inside the cell? And to get an action potential, all that's required then is for this water to change from the fourth phase water, undergo a physical chemical change, a phase change, to ordinary water. And then the potential swings from minus 80 or whatever to around zero. And when the cell recovers, it comes back. So it's possible hypothesis that the electrical potential of the cell comes from the negative charge of the water inside the cell. And when the cell is motivated into activation with an action potential, this action potential is just a reflection of the water changing from this fourth phase water into ordinary water. So that's a tack that we're approaching. It would be a very different interpretation of the negative charge of the cell. But just one point to add to that is that if you take a gel, so you have a cell here, and the inside of the cell is like a gel. It's got a membrane around it. You stick an electrode, you measure minus 80 millivolts, and now you have a gel. And we've done this experiment, others have too. And you stick the same electrode in the gel, there's no membrane, but you get the same result. It can be minus 100, minus 150 millivolts, depending on the kind of gel. See, so the result is the same. In one case, you've got a membrane. In the other case, you have no membrane. But the result is the same. And then it becomes difficult to say that in the cell, the electrical potential is a consequence of the membrane. I know everybody in this room believes it, but I'm just suggesting an alternative hypothesis. So this water is really important for everything involved in our body. I could go on and talk about this stuff for hours, but I think it's a little bit tangential to muscle, but terribly important for everything that goes on in the world around us. You know, water is critical, and there's a huge shortage of water, and we need water, and we need to understand. And the question that I posed initially about, you know, why does the cloud stay up there, clouds water, that question is answerable. In case you want to know, I'll tell you what I think. But water, you know, water used to be a huge topic of scientific interest. And then around the 1950s, when people gained the ability to look at molecules and parts of molecules and parts of molecules, they lost sight of the big picture of, you know, what happens when you put it all back together again. And so they've forgotten that water is so important to everything that our bodies do, and that you need to remain fully hydrated in order to fully function. So, you know, you've played tennis for three matches and you're just about dead, and you sit down and you drink a couple of liters of water and you're back to being energized again. You need that water inside your cells to allow the cells to do everything that the cells do. So the water, if you ask me, is more important than the muscles. The water is so central to our lives and also to everything around us. And we've lost sight of that. Water is no longer a scientific field. Although we've started that because we about a decade ago, we started annual meetings on the physics, chemistry, and biology of water. If anybody's interested, it will be held in Bulgaria this year. And it's a very exciting meeting with new findings from all over, and particularly findings related to health and medicine. So most doctors, medical people, kind of brush aside water as something that's really meaningful, whereas I think it's central to everything that we do, including inside muscle. Read my recent book.